Welcome to Fringe Pop 321, the show that believes the world is stranger than we think, but thinking should not be strange. The internet is cluttered with websites claiming to have found evidence of giant races in ancient America. A Google search for giants plus ancient and America yields over 13 million results. Now, if we believe what most of these websites say, there were races and clans of giants living throughout ancient North America. I've personally collected roughly 200 newspaper stories from late 19th and early 20th century newspapers claiming the discovery of giant human skeletons. But are newspaper stories from this period good evidence for drawing that conclusion? The answer is, well, yes and no. If you're wondering why I'd answer the question that way, you've come to the right place. Now, what I just mentioned about Google searching for ancient American giants sounds pretty impressive, but those websites and giants researchers aren't telling you a few things. The late 19th, early 20th centuries, the period from which all of those newspaper stories about giant skeletons derive, was the heyday of fake news in America. You heard me correctly. There was a golden age of fake news in the United States long before our own time. The reason was simple. Newspapers fought for readers. Newspapers of this era needed circulation to grow to survive in the new journalistic space. Sensationalism sold, and of course it still does. A good P.T. Barnum-esque story would for sure garner readers to the newspaper. The historical reality is that the 19th century saw the transformation of what had been a solidly politically oriented press in early American history to a commercial enterprise. There are book-length studies on this subject, this downward spiral, that document the whole history of this transition. One of the most interesting and entertaining is by Kevin Young, and its title sort of says it all. Bunk. The Rise of Hoaxes, Humbug, Plagiarists, Phonies, Post-Facts, and Fake News. It's a 2017 book, so it's fairly new. Scholars in journalism schools of today are well aware of the fake news boom in this period. During the early 20th century, there was a concerted effort, in fact, to convince reporters and editors to stop doing it, to stop publishing phony news stories. One strategy was the formation of publications, trade publications, specifically targeting the press industry. Press members who wrote for these trade publications and who sought reform of the industry openly advocated jail time for those who kept publishing fake news stories. Now, people today take for granted that media, and especially print media, are supposed to take the high road and report stories with honesty and integrity. Our own recent fake news crisis, though, has destroyed that confidence. But few people realize that this presumed high standard had to be fought for. It was in no way a default goal of earlier print journalism, again, in the late 19th, early 20th centuries especially. This standard that we sort of think is the standard by default today was the result of decades of struggle within the journalistic industry. But let's take that back to the point of it all. The abundance of stories about giant human skeletons, and again, I've collected nearly 200 of them, were often fictional. Without corroborating physical evidence, we have no way of knowing if these newspaper accounts were accurate or just sensationalized fodder to sell subscriptions. We just don't know. And that's not all. Now, the fact that there are abundant stories about ancient giant skeletons being discovered that come from the 19th and early 20th century, again, the golden era of fake news in the United States, isn't the only problem. There's something else to consider, and that is this was also the era of fakery of a grand scale. The old story of the Cardiff giant is probably the most memorable example here. This was a faked giant specimen that made the rounds of carnivals and sideshows, duping tens of thousands of people. Now, the saga of the 10-foot hoax is chronicled by Scott Tribble in his book, A Colossal Hoax, The Giant from Cardiff That Fooled America. The point, of course, is that the historical circumstances poses a reasonable question. In the golden age of fake news, and of course this kind of fakery going on, how reliable are stories of discoveries of giant human skeletons, just broadly speaking? That question is actually more pointed than that, than what we might even be led to believe. It's a factual reality that nearly all the newspaper reports of giant human skeletons from this era failed to produce a single piece of physical evidence. In other words, where are those skeletons? It's simply not adequate to claim that the Smithsonian stole the specimens and hid them away. Again, it sort of reminds me of grade school or middle school where the dog ate my homework. Maybe that could happen, but a couple hundred times, probably not. But as we'll see, the Smithsonian is, in fact, ironically, the only reliable source for giant human skeletal remains. And we need to circle back to the original question with which we began this episode, and the wording here is important. Were there races of giants in ancient America? Now, the answer to that question, as worded, is no. There is simply no physical evidence for that idea. But if we ask whether skeletons of unusually tall people were actually ever discovered in the late 19th, early 20th centuries, the answer to that question is yes. This is why I answered the earlier question at the beginning of the episode, yes and no. Of the hundreds of reports generated during the fake news era of this time, a handful did indeed correspond to an actual skeleton exceeding 7 feet tall. That is documented in credible research sources. And guess where the evidence comes from? The Smithsonian Institution. Now, one of the foundational scientific publications of the late 19th century in regard to ancient American civilization was published in 1894 by J.W. Powell. The title is The 12th Annual Report of the Bureau of Ethnology to the Smithsonian Institution, 1890 to 1891. It's over 800 pages. It's quite a thorough document. The work chronicled the field work of ethnologists, anthropologists, and archaeologists across the United States during the years 1890 through 1891. The report is famous today for being the dagger in the heart to the idea that a lost race of giants from the Middle East or somewhere else was responsible for the building of mounds and earthworks in ancient America. The 12th Annual Report contains 5 short accounts of the discovery of skeletons over 7 feet tall. These were found individually among other skeletons or in isolation. In other words, these are not evidence of a clan of giants being buried or a race of such individuals. All 5 of these reports can be found on the episode webpage on our website. Again, please consult that if you want to read all 5 reports. But here's an excerpt from one on page 362 of the Bureau of Ethnology report. It reads as follows. The length from the base of the skull to the bones of the toes was found to be 7 feet 3 inches. It is probable, therefore, that this individual, when living, was fully 7.5 feet high. Here's another one from page 426. Quote, 19 feet from the top, the bottom of the debris field was reached, where in the remains of a bark coffin, a skeleton measuring 7.5 feet in length and 19 inches across the shoulders was discovered. These 5 instances raise another question. Do these verified reports of 5 Native American skeletons over 7 feet tall validate the notion that there were races of giants in North America? Now, earlier I said that they didn't. We've only got 5 of them from credible sources. But we need to take a little bit of a different look at this. Let's do some math. Now, we're going to do some math here. Specifically, we're talking about statistics. Now, we know that there is reliable evidence for ancient American skeletons over 7 feet tall. And we ask the question, do those reports validate the notion that there were races of giants in North America? Statistically speaking, the answer is a firm no. But let's start with an illustration. Again, sources for these figures are on the episode webpage. An informed statistical analysis in 2012 calculated that there were just under 3,100 people in the world over 7 feet tall. The entire world population in 2012 was estimated at just over 7.1 billion. Now that means that the percentage of people over 7 feet tall was 0.0000005% of the world population. That's six zeros. This percentage has been pretty consistent in modern times. It would likely have been worse in the earlier centuries due to the lack of modern nutritional and medical advances. But let's try to be a bit more accurate in the use of data. Estimates of the pre-Columbian, in other words, before Columbus's arrival, a pre-Columbian native population vary widely in the academic literature. Dean Snow and Douglas Eubelacher, who are professional archaeologists and who have devoted a good deal of research time into ancient demographics, both agree that there were about 2 million Native Americans in North America when Columbus arrived. Other scholars go as high as 18 million in that figure. Now, to be generous to our giant race idea, we'll take this lower overall population number, the 2 million, and we'll double the estimated number of 7-footers to 6,180. Again, by modern standards, we have just over 3,100, or right, just under 3,100 7-footers today, so we'll double that. 6,000 7-footers in round numbers is 0.003% of a population of 2 million. That's nowhere near a race, just by doing the statistical math. To compare this, there are roughly 500,000 pygmies left in the world in Central Africa. Now that is a real minority people group. It's recognized by everyone. The total population of Central Africa, these are 2019 figures, is 4.8 million, or 0.104% of that population, which is exponentially larger than the postulated giant population in North America before Columbus. So in other words, the numbers just simply don't add up. The skeletons over 7 feet tall in reliable sources cannot statistically be pointed to as evidence of a giant race in North America. And even if we go as high as a little over 6,000 skeletons, it just doesn't add up. Basically, these skeletons that we know from reliable sources, again, the Smithsonian material, of the number of 7-footers in those times are representative sort of what we have now today. Again, we have no evidence statistically, archaeologically, or physically of a giant race in North America. Thanks for watching Fringe Pop 321. Please visit our website. This episode, as with all our episodes, have companion web pages, and this episode in particular will have very valuable information for those of you who want to dig deeper. If you like what we're doing here at Fringe Pop 321, please go to fp321.com/S, as in the letter S, to support us. And come back and watch more videos. And please subscribe to our YouTube channel, because what you know may not be so.